Now we're going to switch over to a vertebrate talk. It does make the slide look a little bit nicer though. So I've been working on the Tidewater GUI for quite a while now, and I want to kind of touch on a bunch of different topics, because there's a lot going on, especially in the past year throughout the coast. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the new species of Tidewater GUI we just described last year, and then a lot of the current conservation work we're doing and the status throughout the coast. If you're not familiar with the Tidewater GUI, it's a really small annual species. It's found throughout California, from Del Norte County to northern San Diego County. I know what you're thinking. Hey, Brent, this is a really, really big Tidewater GUI. It's almost like a little mini white sea bass. It is, in fact, the largest Tidewater GUI ever collected. And I take great pride in that, and I'm going to brag about it until someone beats it. So, 62 millimeters. She was released because she's very gravid. But they don't get very big. They do, they like these seasonally closed estuaries. They're especially adapted for these seasonally closed estuaries. If you're not familiar with it, the vast majority of California wetlands are considered closing seasonally closed lagoon habitat. This is probably one of the most pristine sites that still remains in California. It's called Schumann Creek. It's on Vandenberg Air Force Base. And so you can see there's no connection, marine tidal influence. So most of the year, these sites, especially in Southern California, they're closed off to the marine environment through a formation of a sandbar. And so during this time, they are mostly freshwater or brackish. They go through a lot of variation in temperature. They can get really, really hot. And so, you know, it takes a unique species like the Tidewater GUI to be specially adapted for these environments. Because in the winter, when you get these big rain events, the sandbar breaches and it turns into a fully tidal system. And the Tidewater GUI can handle that as well. I've caught gobies in 0 parts per thousand salinity and very hypersaline conditions at 65 parts. So they're really a hardy fish. But there's just a few of these sites that we consider pristine, and it really shows what California used to look like prior to development. Unfortunately, this is what most of the lagoons look like now. They're heavily impacted, they've been reduced in size, either through urbanization, agriculture, things like that. So this is what's led to the endangerment of the Tidewater GUI. It was federally listed in 1994. Right now it's managed as 6 different recovery units, and these were designated through a lot of work my advisor did, Dave Jacobs, through some genetic work, which I'll show in a second. But there's a lot of, local and regional differentiation through, molecular genetics, and it's also a very unique metapopulation structure. Especially, you have these very warm systems down south that, or experience desiccation, and then you have sites up north that really don't experience that. So there is a lot of differences in just metapopulation structure. Also, it's one of the few systems that has more of like a linear metapopulation structure on a latitudinal scale. Usually you get like the patches randomly distributed, and so it is a very unique system. A lot of the work Dave did using microsats has shown that the South Coast unit is a distinct species, and we recently described it last year. It's been isolated from the rest of the coast for quite a long time. I'm not going to go too much into the genetics, but just to show you, this is some work Dave did in 2010, and using microsats, you can see how distinct this is. 15 and 16 is the South Coast unit. These numbers correlate to bootstrap levels. So with 100% bootstrap support, this South Coast unit is highly distinct compared to the rest of the coast. It also has a lot, it's very different with just overall bill size. And so the work that he did really shows, it merits that the South Coast unit is a distinct species. It's actually more genetically distinct than any simonid ESU. And so it really shows that these isolated lagoonal habitats, cause a lot of long-term separation between populations. So we described the new species. It came out last year, so now there is a northern and a southern tidewater goby. Very exciting. As you can see, they look very different. Not really. The southern species is the newly described one, so it's a Cyclogobus christinae. It was named after a fellow Bruin in Dave's lab before I got there, who passed away unexpectedly, far before her years, so we named it after her, in memory of her. And so, also, on top of the genetics, it's actually very morphologically different. You can't really tell when you just look at pictures. But just to go over a few of them, for the few diagrams I'm going to show, the blue correlates with the northern species, Nuberiae, and then red is the new species, Christinae. So just looking at fin ray counts, pectoral and caudal fins have more significantly more fin ray counts in Nuberiae, and that is similar or kind of goes along with the length of their caudal fins. So there's a lot of characters that are different. I'm not going to focus on all of them, but basically the thicker lines mean they're more significantly different. All of these are significantly different amongst the species. The thicker lines are kind of the more distinguishable characters through morphology. And so you can see just the overall take-home message from this is that the northern species has longer pectoral and caudal fins, which is why it has more fin rays. But it's the southern species is just a more robust fish. It has a bigger head, it's wider, it's got a longer anal fin or anal spine. And we think in ecological terms, it's really because the southern species takes a more benthic tank type of lifestyle, whereas the northern species are more free swimming. And I've seen this in all of my surveys. You actually see the northern species swim around a lot more. It utilizes a lot of the algal habitat and things like that, where the northern species is really more of a benthic species. And also, looking at the neuromass, there is a variation in the neuromass counts for both species, but this one, number one right here, that is double circled, it's actually uniformly distinct between populations. So that, if you happen to have a tidewater goby and you're actually not certain which species it would be, you can look at that one neuromass and it can distinguish between the populations through that. So that's the morphometrics in a nutshell. We've also found a lot of distinct characters, sexually dimorphic characters. So this is with both species. The female in general is just a much larger individual, which we kind of already knew. But what's cool is this is a sexual reverse species. So the males dig the burrows and they brood the eggs. And so you can see in the mandibles and the overall head structure, the males have a larger mouth and head. So it's because they are digging and they're actively fanning the eggs with their mouth. So pretty cool stuff with that. This is the map that shows the separation of Nuberiae and Christinae. And so it's really at the Palos Verdes shelf. The gobies just, it makes sense. This is really a rocky area. Gobies can't really move around this rocky point. And so we expect the natural range for Christinae was, southern Palos Verdes down to La Jolla. The historic range, which has been documented, is this brown line. But unfortunately, they've been reduced to three sites that are only found in Camp Pendleton. So it's actually up to four now. I got an email a couple weeks ago saying that one of the sites was colonized, which is cool. But still, this new species was only found in a handful of sites. As you can see, they're really small sites. They're not big. So they are kind of in immediate threat of extinction. A couple drought years could really, do harm to this species. So current status, it's up for reclassification. It's actually a petition for reclassification in 2014. It's currently in review, and we're working a lot with U.S. Fish and Wildlife to do there's two major criteria that was listed on the recovery plan. One of them is the metapopulation modeling, and so that's what I'm currently working on. and then trying to enforce individual management plans throughout the coast. And that actually hasn't been done for any of them. So hopefully we can get there before there's a decision made on reclassification. For the metapopulation modeling, in the recovery plan, it states that at least 10 years of presence-absence surveys need to be done to inform the model. And if it was, so when you run the model, in order for the species to be downlisted from endangered to threatened, it needs a 75% probability of persisting for 100 years or more. And that is for every single metapopulation, not just, you know, the entire coast. Every metapopulation or subunit needs to meet that criteria, which is difficult. What's even more difficult is that we don't have 10 years of data. You know, this fish was listed in 94, but there hasn't been a lot of surveys going on. And so we've been working really hard to create a tidewater goby database. It's actually pretty extensive now. I was very fortunate to have Cam Swift send me 40 years of his handwritten field notes, which has all been digitized and put into this database. And for more current surveys, I've been surveying pretty much the entire coast of California since 2014. I'm up to about 158 sites that I survey every year. 122 of them, which I'll show in a second, are what we consider like could have tidewater gobies. But I work a lot with state parks because a lot of these areas fall within state parks territories. This is basically my home, my laboratory, my office for about 3 months a year. I actually just got back. It's nice to sleep in a real bed. And so we do a lot of these presence absence surveys. And so just real quickly, I start at the Greater Bay Unit. So basically Bodega Bay down to the South Coast. I have 122 sites. And actually during the warmest years, 2014, 2015, I found them in 73 sites. And this past year I found them in 70 sites. So they seem pretty stable. I think it's actually leading towards that the northern species is gonna be downlisted or threatened, which I'm okay with. But what we're really trying to work on is to make sure that the South Coast unit is remains endangered. There's a couple cool sites. I don't know if anyone's in these areas, but we've found actually gobies in a lot of sites, like new sites that have never been documented before. So some of them are up in like Santa Cruz area. There's San Luis Obispo Creek. We found them within the past 2 years in here. Unfortunately, they've been extirpated from Santa Barbara in these three sites. And Las Flores was that new site in San Diego that they just found them in. So there's a lot of, you know, positive things going on, finding the new sites. That might be just because we're actually looking for them now and they haven't really been surveyed for a while. But nonetheless, they seem to be doing pretty well. But just because they're present doesn't mean that, you know, they're abundant and healthy in these sites. They're extremely impacted by urbanization. This little pond right here, which is smaller than this motorhome up here, had about 200 tidewater gobies in it, which is amazing. So they're really hardy fish as long as there's habitat for them. Desiccation has significantly reduced the size of these sites. Invasives are one of the biggest problems now. It seems to keep increasing the number of fish that are found in sites and amphibians. And one of the big things now is there's a microsporidium infection that's going throughout the coast, which is a fungal infection that affects the tissues, and it basically eats away the tissue. And that's spreading throughout the coast, and we're not sure why, so we're trying to figure that out. And then there's sites that, you know, have multiple impacts. This is Winchester Bell. It's not only affected by drought, urbanization, but there's a fracking location just upstream. In 2012, there was a leak into the stream, and now there's no more gobies. So there's a lot of different things that are impacting the gobies. When they are removed from the system, it basically turns into a mosquito fish pond. So they are really foundational pieces to these seasonally closed estuaries, and a lot of people don't realize that. You know, we look, the vast majority of the systems, like I said before, are seasonally closed throughout California. And we look at it, kind of, these systems as like a hydrologic continuum where they go from, you know, freshwater closed to open tidal systems. You know, you have this freshwater rupia widgeon grass to marine algae. And there's one fish that really can stand both of these habitats and is like the foundational piece in the trophic structure. They are food for red-legged frogs, steelhead have been known to eat them, halibut. So it is really important to, you know, kind of look at this fish as one of the keystone type species for these habitats, because they are really a foundational piece for them. And so I like to just end on this slide. This is one of my favorite sites in Arroyo de Tortuga in San Simeon. This is a really small site. This is all widgeon grass. And not only is there abundance of tidewater gobies here, but there is a number of endangered and threatened species found in this small lagoon. Red-legged frogs, western pond turtles. I was just there about 2 weeks ago, and there was about 20 western pond turtles basking on a rock. It's really cool. California new. And so if you think about, you know, if you remove the tidewater goby from this habitat, you start introducing these invasives, you know, you're not only impacting the tidewater goby, but you're impacting a lot of these other, you know, endemic species that utilize this habitat. So we're working really hard with a variety of agencies to create this model to not only, you know, help the tidewater goby for the reclassification, but also to provide a tool for everybody to use for a variety of species that are found in these critically important habitats of the coast. So with that, I'd like to thank all the people that have helped me, and yeah, take any questions if there's time.